this run must have been like so hard, just like being in his and all that. He was probably just like,
last year we lost one of our most beloved and important speakers. Every year, for many years, Lillian Judd would speak to us and countless other groups of her exceptional life. As a survivor of Auschwitz, Lillian was committed to ensuring that no one would forget. That as decades passed, new generations would understand what had happened to people during the Holocaust. Lillian spoke to this lecture series into her 90s. And every semester, students consistently felt that her presentation was one of the most important and the most moving. For years, Lillian was supported by her devoted son, Dennis. He is an outstanding representative of the second generation, the children of the survivors. Since Lillian's passing, Dennis has worked very hard to make sure that her story is not lost to history. His resolve is exactly what we need between memory and history. We are very grateful that the film you will see today has been made. Lillian Judd's story is one that should be heard for generations to come. Few can offer as powerful testimony to the resiliency and the determination of the human spirit. Please welcome Dennis Judd.
Am I on? Can you hear me? Great. I want to thank you all for coming, and thank you all for letting me come. I'm going to give a little bit of background about our family. Basically, you know, I'm Dennis Judd, and we grew up in the San Fernando Valley of Los Angeles. My mom, Lillian, and my father, Emil, and my brother, Irv, they all immigrated to the U.S. from Czechoslovakia after World War II. My brother was 2 years old at that time. Both my parents, they met after the Holocaust, but both of them were Holocaust concentration camp survivors, which means that they went through the concentration camps. They lived through that, survived that. As we grew up as second generation, my older brother Irv and I thought we were growing up in a typical Southern California kids. We'd go to the movies, we'd play Little League. We had friends and the whole interaction of typical normal people, typical average Americans, so to speak, in the San Fernando Valley, whatever that is. But as I started to work with my mom, I started thinking about, well, what was it really like being a second generation? Was there anything different? And parts of the differences that I think we have to think about is I didn't have any grandparents that were alive. So I grew up without grandparents. Our family was missing, I was missing so many of my aunts and uncles who were murdered and my cousins that were murdered by the Germans and the Hungarian Nazis. Basically, there was a gap of life in our family. I had one cousin that survived the camps. He was 14 when he was in the camps. And then my next oldest cousin was Isaac, and he was born in Cyprus at the detention camp while his mother and father were waiting to go to Israel. So there was like about a 15-year gap of life that didn't exist in our family. We didn't have any family keepsakes. Everything that was in Europe, that had been in Europe that my parents grew up with, was all got lost and stolen and taken. So my parents basically came here to the United States not speaking English with $20 in their pocket. They were lucky that we had some relatives here. My uncle Leonard was here already, so they were able to get some help that way. As we grew up, I was the youngest of all of the family, all the cousins and so forth. And I remember hearing stories about what life was like back in Czechoslovakia. It was fun to hear the stories. And of course, each year, as my dad would talk about walking to school, the snow got a foot deeper and the school got about a mile further out. But it was fun. It was good stories. We would get together with our family, the cousins, my cousins and aunts and uncles that survived. They all ended up coming to San Fernando Valley also. So we all grew up as an extended family. But I also remember the many times where in the middle of the night I was woken up when my father or mother were screaming because they were having their terrible nightmares, reliving what had gone on in the concentration camps. And for my mom, it was after one of these nightmares that she decided it was time to write her story. So she began typing on her old manual typewriter. And that was back in the 1980s, pretty much before computers were around. Over the many years that she started to write her story, she was able to transcend into a nicer person. She was able to be happier, and she wasn't carrying all of that, all of it inside of her that she'd carried for all those years. As that happened, she was able to start talking more about her experiences in school. And she hadn't done that before. Most Holocaust survivors hadn't been doing that, especially in the 60s and 70s. So she and I started working together, talking at schools. She moved up here. My parents moved up here back in what would have been the late 90s. And so she gave talks to high schools, junior high schools, colleges, and so forth. And then she and I worked on her book. She had put together her memoirs, and I had to, it took me about 10 years of my time working with her to transition that into our book, which is what we show here, From Nightmare to Freedom, Healing After the Holocaust. And a big piece of this was that she was teaching people, and her message was to let go of your anger before it turns to hatred. Or let go of your hatred before it turns to anger. My head's spinning a little bit today. But also to forgive. And so that was a big part of her talk. Back in about 2010, after our book was published, I hired a camera crew to come and film Mom while she was telling her stories. And we ended up with about 4 hours of high-definition digital recording. So we have about four to five hours of recordings. You're not going to see it all today. Last February, when we were coming, Mom and I were coming here to one of the lectures, and as we started to go up the steps, she basically collapsed and had a stroke. And so that was a rough time. It's still been rough for me. We worked with her for a year, for probably about 4 months. She tried so hard to get better, and we were doing the best we could. And then she ended up with a double stroke hitting her in June, and that was pretty much, that was it. She couldn't do anymore. So while we were going through the healing process, a lot of people offered their help. And one person was Dr. Lori Lippin, who's a university professor from UC Davis. And she's the one that I knew that kind of gave me the kick in behind to get the book finished. And so I said, well, what I could use help from you is, can you help to edit the 4.5 hours? And she said, oh, a piece of cake, we'll get together and do it. And well, she came over and we realized it wasn't a piece of cake. So she took it to UC Davis, and she was able to get a professor there, and who assigned a student and an aide. And they edited it down to about 45 minutes, which is what you're going to see today. So what would be very special that I'm looking forward to, and I don't know if you address the Moodle page? Moodle. A different word. If you guys saw that, basically I gave information on how to get access to the book at the best discounts we can give. So it's either ebook or a hard book, hard copy. But I also put some questions in there or areas for comments, because I would love to hear back from you, and you can contact me that way. So as Mom passed away, okay, we better do some changing of film, sorry. We did a lot of stuff. We went to Washington, D.C. We were invited to do a book signing at the Holocaust Museum. Senator Feinstein invited us to her office, which was real special. Do one more. There we are signing books, and let's do one more. We even got Elie Wiesel to respond to us, which was pretty special to me. when we had the funeral procession with, at the cemetery with Mom, in the Jewish tradition, you put the casket into the ground, and then you take a shovel and you start to shovel about 3 scoopfuls of earth onto the casket. So I was the first one doing that. And then I went and sat down underneath this awning, and other people were doing it. There's a long line. There's a lot of people that came. And I started looking at people, and they're all pointing up in the sky. And I'm like, what's going on? You know, they're all just like looking up in the sky. And I came out of the awning and looked up. And let's do the one more. There was basically a rainbow that started forming, and it formed around the sun. And it wasn't like there were clouds or anything. It was just there. So that was my message. That was my mom's message to me and to everybody that was there, that she's where she wants to be and needs to be. So I'm going to show you the video now. We can flip over to the video. And you can watch this. I'd like it if you could think about how it touches you, impacts you, and if there's any suggestions you have, because it's still a bit of a work in progress, and I think there's still some room, but I would love to hear input from the students and so forth. So let's start with this.
My name is Lillian Judd. I was born in Czechoslovakia, Ushorod. I'm a Holocaust survivor, and I would like to thank you all for inviting me to speak to you, especially your teachers and the principal and whoever. I would like to make the presentation so that you would be with me, come walk with me. At first, before I go any further, I would like to ask you to get rid of your hatred. Don't carry your hatred in your heart. Get rid of it. Talk to your teachers, talk to your counselors, talk to your parents, even to a policeman. Just don't carry it, because it will turn into hatred. And hatred brings prejudice and other bad things to your heart. So get it out and start now. I was 14 years old in 1938 when I completed my high school. And I was ready to go further schooling to study for some job, secretary or something. And but the Hungarian army came in under Hitler, and it changed the whole situation. And life was hard. There were all kinds of different orders and intimidation passed all the time. We didn't know what brings tomorrow, but we heard something like they right away. Established a forced labor camp, and the boys from the camps used to come home for 2-3 days on weekends, and they were telling us about how they were killing the Jews on the Polish border and made the Jewish people stand around it and undress. And no sooner they were undressed, they didn't have much time to think about it, because the SS started to machine gun them down from every side, and they were just falling into the hole. And as soon as all of them fell in, the bulldozer started to shovel the dirt back at them. Some people said, the Polish people, after the war, that the ground was moving for a long time. Later, to dehumanize us more and more, they gave out orders, and we had to wear the yellow star on our outer garments. We could not go out, leave the house without them. And that will announce that I'm a Jew. The intimidation orders of departure or relocation started to come regularly. And as in a few couple of weeks, it became a reality that we will have to leave. We came out to that point where we had to meet. When I saw that sight, it made me sick. I can never forget it. Those little eyes, the children, the old people, so desperate, so sad. They had tears in their eyes. They were scared. They didn't know what to expect. They never told us where we're going or why. They just took us, or then they gave us orders to stand up by five to a row and start marching. We arrived somewhere, and there I looked up, and there was the old brick factory. And then the guard said, "Now, here you are. This will be your ghetto." Now they opened the gate and you go in. They did open the gates, high gates, high fence gates. They were all brought in, the children, the old people, and they were sitting in there, and they had some straw under them, and it looked like a zoo. It was terrible. They were all so wild looking. And we came in and we didn't have where to sit, where to go, because those things were filled. So they just pointed out a piece of the cement or whatever there was of the ground and told us that here, this is where you have to go and build yourself something to sleep under. And this was for 6 weeks. We ran out of food, we ran out of everything. And we were in the ghetto. We didn't know what's where. In the evening we sat together on the lawn, talking. There were a lot of people there that we didn't know, but we talked to them and we talked to the people and we made kind of friends. Then, end of the 6 weeks. Came out the Hungarian soldiers. They picked us up and said, "You get ready for morning. Take all your have, everything you have, and go and line up on that corner." And kept on doing this until there was a whole transport, a whole bunch of people. We didn't know them, so we were standing up five to a row, and then a bunch of this little Hitlerjugend came, and they all had a switch, and the leader said that you have to move on because if not, those kids are here to help you with a switch. So I was just worried about that because he couldn't walk fast enough. So I said, bend on me, lean on me as much as you have to, and I'll help you, and we'll go faster so that we wouldn't get hit. And we did, all the way until we saw the railroad station. We looked up and we saw there these black cars, and they were all open, and as far as I could see to either side, they were covered. They were full of them. And all of a sudden they started to say, get in, for us. So we didn't expect to be in an animal wagon, so it took us time. And we go into the wagon. We take the little bags that we have, and there are so many people there that we can't even sit down anymore, or hardly. And they packed like this all the wagons, and at the end there were leftover people, so they pushed in more and more into each wagon. Now I hear them closing the gates. And I hear the wheels starting to screech. And we're on our way. no water, no food, no toilet facilities. We're just going. We don't know how long, we don't know where. And then we stopped because they were taking in, I don't know, whatever they were running the train with, they were taking in water and coal and I don't know what. And we were waiting there. And I looked out on that station and I saw there the men that were working there, happily smiling that they see the Jews going to be killed, because they knew where they're taking us, we didn't. So they took us to the, and they showed us like, this is where you're going to be killed and all that. So it depressed us, and that they were so happy about it, even depressed us more. And the thing went on, and then we were further going on the train. And we stopped again. I look up, we're still in Poland. But I saw the people on the station, the working people. They were so sad. They had tears in their eyes. And they're looking at us. And they knew where they're taking us, so that's why they were very sad. These were the same country's people, Poland. And the first group was happy to see us being killed. The second group was sad and cried for us. I learned something there. I learned that you cannot judge a whole country for a group of people or two groups of people. In the same country, there are good people and bad people. So at this point, we're going further. I don't know, I think we were on the road already 4 days and nights, and I hear the train slowing down and stopping, screeching to a stop. And when the gates opened and I was standing there, light in front of me, I thought I'm going blind from the sun, from the light that came in from outside. But and they were hollering at us, somebody, the Germans, hurry up, get off the train, not, without the packages, get off. And then Dad, I had Dad to come down from the train, and he was still holding that little thing, that little bag that he was holding with his prayer objects. And the Nazis saw it. And he came over and he turned the rifle butt around, the rifle around, and with the butt he started to hit him over his head, over his shoulders. Pretty soon the blood was just coming out. And I'm standing there and crying and looking, and I don't know what to do. And I just said, stop. Stop, but he didn't pay attention to me. And he just beat him until he fell. To me, he looked like dead, and probably was. And he was still ready to hit. And I said, why did you have to kill him? He didn't do anything. And he turned around, and those eyes I never forgot, so full of hatred. So full of ready to kill like an animal's eyes. And he lifted his thing, his rifle butt, and said, you want to go with him? And I looked up at him and I turned away and pushed myself between the other people that were already gathering out from the other wagons. And he just motioned to two prisoners. And they ran over, and they were in striped uniforms. They ran over, and they picked up Dad's, each one of them picked up one of his feet, one of his foot, and he was dragging them down on that uneven ground. And his head was bouncing and leaving a bloody mark all the way to the truck that they were taking him, and then threw him on the truck. And I never saw him again. After my dad was murdered, and I came from to look for my mom, I noticed that there were no men, and just women and children there. And I found them, and we had to force lines, five, and we were exactly five. And mom was on the end, and she was seeing more what was going on ahead than I. And she was saying, oh, they are separating us. And if they remove any one of you from me, I'm as good as dead. And she kept on saying it and repeating it. And I had nowhere to consult her. I didn't know what to say. I needed somebody to put their arms around me too and tell me that everything's going to be okay. But there was no one. So we just kept walking, and pretty soon we came to the person that were separating. He was a good-looking officer in white uniform, white gloves, and just very quiet, very calmly moving his finger to the left and to the right, pointing to you and to the right and to the left, and then you just had to obey his finger. And that, I found out later, that was the infamous Dr. Mengele, Joseph Mengele. And I told my little sister, my sister Renee, who was the second sister from me. And she I told her, Renee, pull yourself down a little bit so you could go with mom, so she wouldn't be just with the baby. And I don't know if she did pull herself down or not, but she was taken with mom. And I have my life to think about. Did I give her the good advice, or would I be better off to be quiet? But at that time, I thought it was good. It was the best thing I could do. They were calling us such wild names, the Nazis, such ugly, terrible names. But they just pushed and hurry up and go. And there was no place to go because we were so close together with the people that walked ahead of me that if I would make a bigger step, I would step on him, her. And we were walking and walking until we came close to a building, a gray building. And when we came close, I noticed that people only went in five at a time, but nobody came out. So what happened? What's going on there? We found out. Pretty soon our turn came and we went in. And I looked down on the ground, on the floor, and there was thick layer of hair. All colored hair, different shades, different colors on the floor. And about six Germans hollering, take everything off, take all your clothes off. And I didn't move because I figured, I never undressed in front of men, maybe they're gonna go out. So I could undress. They didn't go out and I didn't undress. And their helpers, the girls, came and started to pull my clothes off and throw it on the floor. I said, why are you throwing my clean clothes on the floor, on the dirty floor? How am I going to find them? She says, you won't have to find them. You will just have to, they will give you other clothes. And they just pushed me into a chair naked. And I see her coming up with something shiny in her hand. And I look, and it is a shaver. And she comes and she starts to shave my hair. And I grabbed her hand and started pushing her. And I said, what are you doing? She said, just be quiet. Be quiet. We have to do it. And I couldn't do anything else but be quiet anyhow. So they shaved my hair and every hair on my body and everybody else's. Like a rock. And he says, now go into that other room. And I go to the other room naked, just shoes on. No hair, no clothes. I had the shoes they let us keep. go in there, and I look around. There were a few people there already. And I figured that's why nobody ever came out after they went in. And then Herzi came in. And she looked. I started to cry when I saw her. I couldn't see myself. There were no mirrors or anything for to see how I looked. But when I saw her, I started to cry. What did they do that to that beautiful little girl? She was a very pretty little girl. And they cut her hair and naked. She just looked terrible, and I looked terrible, and we both started to cry. All of a sudden, the cold water was opened, and we were getting a shower. At first, it shocked us, the cold water, but then we enjoyed it, how good it felt after 4 days to get finally washed up. And they were hollering, now are you out for Zeelapper? We didn't know what Zeelapper was. We did not have a towel. They didn't. Some girls said, how come they don't give us a towel? We had to dry outside. It was so cold outside. I was freezing. I thought my bones were freezing. And we had to stand there naked. That was so embarrassing, so dehumanizing. And on the other side, much further on the other side, I saw the men, they were taking the men probably to do the same thing. And I just said, God, please make me invisible. And we were still standing there until finally they let us go. They led us into the building, and they said, now you come and you get some clothes. And those were clothes that when they had later, I found out about it, that later they had the selections, and some people were already not fit for work, so they took them to the crematorium, to the gas. And those clothes that they took off from those people, they were giving it to us. We were lucky that we got the water, but the other groups got the gas at the same place, and then the crematorium. But we didn't know it then yet. So anyways, we were marching. We were put together and we were marching to one place. And that was the sea lager called. And there, in number 32, we stood. And that was supposed to be our home. Now we have to wait until the block supervisor comes out and receives us. So I was looking at around what was there. And I saw there a big building. And on the building, there was a small piece of glass window. And I could see all the naked heads there. And I said, which one am I? And they all looked like monkey. Which monkey am I? And I'm looking and I couldn't recognize myself. Then I went like this and I recognized myself. And then I started to cry because now I saw how I looked. So then we were standing some more longer because then she took us in and she said, my name is Edith and I'm from Slovakia and I'm here for 4 years already and you will do what I tell you or else. And here are my 12 helpers. They all had heavy canes in their head and they would hit, had the authority to hit us. 10 minutes later that we are there, we all jumped up and we ran to the gates. And the block elders came out, the block supervisor, and says, "What do you think you're doing? What's the matter with you?" She says, and we said, "We want to see our family." And she says, "You can't." Then go back. And they pushed us back to the bunks. And about 5 minutes later, they went into their little room, and we jumped up again, ran to the gates. This time she came out and she says, "So, you want to see your family?" And we said, "Yes." "Okay," and she takes a key. And we thought, how could she change so fast? Before she wouldn't let us see our family. Now she's opening the gate and she's going to let us see our family. Wonderful. She opens the gate. We saw outside was dark already. And the smell, such an obnoxious smell, made us feel like throw up. They were burning the human flesh. And that smell is terrible. I look at the sky, and it was a vivid red. The whole sky I could see was vivid red. And all that redness came from the crematorium that was there, not far from us. And I couldn't figure out, what is this? Where is that redness coming? And I'm just waiting, like all of us, to be taken to it, to see our family. We thought they were in another barrack. Then she says, "You want to see your family?" "Yes." "Look up. There they are burning." And she pointed to the sky. And then we believed her. We believed that they were there burning, because we smelled it, and we saw the people going, more and more people going there. And then we started to cry. We were pushed to the bed, and we were crying all night. We didn't want any dinner. We were crying all night. Then we were there about a week when they called us out and said, "Extend your left arms. Stand up and stand in one single row," and we had to pull our sleeves, if we had sleeves up, and some woman came with something that looked like a fountain pen in her hands. But she started to push it into my arm. It didn't feel like a fountain pen because it was hurting, and the blood was coming out, and the ink was mixing with the blood. And I said, "We're surely going to get some infection." And sure enough, two days later, it was infected. Well, we had no antibiotics. Nobody even looked at it. It just, they couldn't keep it clean. There was no water. It just, by nature, it healed. It dried out, and we have the number. From then on, we were the numbers only. Finally, they found us at work. They were in between, always calling for selections, and they were always separating us. And boy, that was so scary, especially, like, I have my sister, so I didn't want her to be taken away from me. So I always put her in front of me, and I always thought that if they're going to put, I'm watching which way they're separating us, if I see stronger people on one side and the weaker on the other side, I'm going to see where Herzi goes. She goes to the stronger people when I flex my muscle, which there wasn't much. And if I see her go to the weaker side, then I just let go. That's what I decided to do. But thank God I never had to, because we always went the same way. Then we were taken to another place, and they were choosing people for where they supposed to make cloths. We took three cut rockets and one rubber. We made a knot on the end and hooked it on the nail on the table. And then we had to braid it like you would braid hair. There was a big long tables, chair for everybody. And in front of each chair, there was a nail knocked into the table. And they gave us a quota how many meters we had to do a day. And we were trying it, and I was so slow at it, and I was trying so hard. I was always the last one to finish my quota. And they were always threatening us, if you don't finish your quota, they put you out and keep the hose with the cold water on you until you freeze to death. One day this lady comes over to us that came there with three daughters, and she says, "You know, kids, Yom Kippur is coming up. How about let's do something so we could keep Yom Kippur?" She says, "Let's make a little bit extra toward our quota every day so we would have the quota completed." We all did that, even I. And we would just keep doing it, and I never found out what they're going to do with it. But we were doing it, and then Yom Kippur comes. We were pretending to work, but the couple noticed it. And she noticed it by the girl two chairs away from me. And she came over, and she started to go like this, looking, "What do we have here that we don't work?" And she found her bundle, and she pulled out, "What's this? And you're not working." And she beat her up so that the poor kid could hardly talk afterward. And they beat here like this on the head, so that the head felt like it was flying off. She came to the next to me, the girl. Found hers and beat her up, came to me and beat me up so that I saw double, triple. And then I just said, "God, why? Why, God? I'm following your law. I'm following your commandment. What am I doing wrong? Please at least take her strength away so she wouldn't have enough strength to beat Herzi up." Because Herzi was a couple chairs down. And sure enough, she came after me to the next one and beat her up. And then she says, "What are you doing to me? I haven't got any strength. I can't go on." And she went away. So thank God that God listened to me and stopped her before Herzi was beaten. Because after this, I had mixed feelings as far as religion. I was beaten on Yom Kippur because I tried to do the right thing, but Herzi was saved because I asked God for it. We were struggling like this until December. Black elders, they gave us orders to line up for Zelapel. And we didn't want to go out, we rebelled. And then the Nazis came with a gun and started to shoot in the barracks. They took us to the shower, they shaved us again everywhere, and we're ready to go someplace, only we didn't know where. We got in those boxcars, and they even gave us a bucket of water. And then pretty soon, we made one turn by the track, and we look up and it says, "Welcome to Bergen-Belsen." That was a deadly camp. And we stopped and we were getting out, tired, hungry, cold, and there were no place to go. there were buildings there, they were all occupied. And the cement there, they pointed out a small little circle, this is where you stay. Somebody, and I was so sick already, because I had a bladder infection and I was very sick, and there was no place to even wash. I said to the two girls, two Hungarian girls, and to my sister, because by then we made friends. I said, I am getting out of here. And they looked at me, they thought I went crazy. Wouldn't be surprised if I did, but no, I really wanted to get out of there. How are you going to get out of here? I said, I don't know yet, but I want to get out of here. I don't, otherwise I would die here in this place. And I don't want to die after what I went through in Auschwitz. So we dropped the subject and we were just sleeping on the ground, on the cement. Then a couple mornings later, we went out for a walk, four of us. And I saw there a man standing in uniform, in civilian clothes, nicely dressed, and a few women are standing in front of him, and he's selecting. Hey, there is our chance. I'm going in the line. She says, what? The older girl said, what if they take us to a worse place than this? I said, I don't think there is a worse place anymore than this. And I'm going, and whoever wants to come with me, fine. If you all want to stay, that's your business. They followed me, all three, my sister and those two sisters. We stood in line, and they were selecting all the Hungarian sisters to the right to go, and Herzi over there, and me, they pushed on the other side. I don't know what they were looking for, but me pushed the other side. And I'm pushing myself back, quietly, sneakily. I am pushing myself back because I don't want to stay here. I was the one who wanted to get out of here. And I'm pushing myself toward my sister. And I wanted to go in before the man noticed me. He says, hey, I thought I told you go to the other side. Yes, but my sister there in German. Oh, okay, you go too. You go to with your sister. So that was so sweet of him. I kind of changed my mind somewhat about the Germans. And every now and then something good was done to me by a German, so that I thought there must be two kind of people there too. These miserable killers, murderers, and some between them are still honestly good people. So anyhow, I went together with my sister. They took us someplace. We never knew where, in a covered truck. But when they put us down, it was a factory, no name on it, so I don't know where I was. It was like a condo, and we got one bed for two of us and two blankets. So that was more comfortable. Then they brought us every week beautiful, clean, not new, but clean clothes. And they brought us in the food from the restaurant. And they said that here, we want you to be treated humanly. And they did treat us humanly. And we want you to survive. And, you know, we weren't human anymore. We were like animals. Some of us worse than others. Some of them even went on the lawn, and everything was so nice and clean and orderly. And then we were telling them not to do that, and slowly it straightened out. And we were there, and we were taken, and we were really taken humanly. We were treated good. But then came the order to evacuate. Then we had to leave. And then we started to march, and we were marching, going with no aims. They don't know, the Germans, Nazis don't know where we're going, we're just going. Then all of a sudden we hear the siren. Didn't mean anything to me anymore. But the Nazis were hiding and said to us, run, run and hide, and don't come up until we get you. I grabbed Herzi's hand and we were running, 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 and we come up to a field that was covered with maybe broccoli, not completely grown. And we sat down there, and we are waiting, and we are... And then we saw the broccoli, and we went to it, and we ate it, and ate it, and ate it. We were kept taking the top off and eating it. I don't know how we didn't get sick from it, but I bet the farmer got sick when he came out and saw all the all his crop grown. Yeah. Anyways, we came down, and all the transport is gone. Nobody's there. What are we going to do here? So we start to walk, and there we saw a house just above us, and there were some people standing and talking about the alarm, about the air raid, and we went up there and asked if they would give us something to eat. And they just didn't even look at us, just walked into the house without even anything. So we're going further. Then I even went to the police station and to ask what to do. And they said, well, why don't you go after the transport? Because we have no place to put you, to send you. And you know what? We were thinking. So we have our freedom. We don't know what to do with it. So we went and joined back the transport. And it was okay because some of them didn't even notice that we were gone. And we were just marching more. And then the SS were standing around by themselves in a circle and started to talk quietly, whispering among themselves. And then we are on the paved road where there were forests on each side. And the SS started to holler, run, run, run. Didn't explain why or what they want. Just run. And we didn't move. So then they came with a rifle and started to scare us and chase us. And when I saw her coming with a rifle, I grabbed Herzi's hand and jumped into the forest. And we were running, running, running. I don't know where we got the energy, but we ran. And we came to a clearance, and there I saw a man working. And I went up and I asked in German, could you please give us something to eat? I didn't know how many people were behind me already. And he fed us. He says, I only have milk and bread that I can give you. That's great. We didn't have milk since home. So he fed us the bread and milk. Then I asked him, would you please tell us what part of the world are we in? And he says, this is the Sudetenland. And I knew that the Sudetenland was part of Czechoslovakia. And I started to talk Czech to him. And the girls behind me said, tell him that we're going to work for free just for food for him. And he says, no, it's no need. You are free. The war is over. That's the first time I heard that the war was over. And you can go home. They came with an ambulance and took us to the hospital. And then we were checked out and given beds and some clean clothes. Then we were put to another place where we were kept for weeks and fed oatmeal in the morning and then at noon and at night. And then we started to walk home. It was a long time to get home because the trains the tracks were bumped every here and there. So then we had to walk or whatever, which way to get to the next train station. So it took us a long time. And I, meantime, developed a fantasy that my mother will survive and will wait for us at home. And I was strong, right from the beginning of my concentration camp time. And I was so sure in it that my mom will come home. And then we were coming home already. A lot of things happened on the way and all that. Finally, we are in our own hometown, and some people recognized us and came, and they weren't sure, but came to talk and asked where are my parents and sisters. And we told them, and then we go up to our property. There I look up. There we went to our pump, and we sat down there, and Kai Herzi went to knock on our door. Nobody opened it. So we were crying outside, and then somebody called out, "Go away, this is not your house anymore, it's my home." I don't even know who it was, but I think it's from Russia. They brought in some people and took our homes. And then I said, "Mom isn't here. God, why did I survive? Mom isn't here. Our house, they won't let us in. What am I going to do? No hope. What are we going to do? What are we supposed to do?" And then I look up and I see my neighbor across the street, a Gentile neighbor lady come up, running toward us with tears in her eyes. She says, "Come kids, come to my house, I'll take care of you." And she did. I had this nightmare. I had nightmares all the time. But this nightmare came up and I woke up screaming and in tears and scared, because I just saw that my dad was killed there, and I saw that blood and everything, so so real looking. And I couldn't stop crying afterwards. I kept seeing it. Usually a nightmare, just once I wake up, it goes away. This one didn't want to leave me. And I thought to myself, I better sit down and write about it, because I won't get rid of it until then, before. And then I decided that next morning I had an old clunker typewriter and I started to type. I took typing classes, so I was able to type my story. And as I was typing, at first I didn't think it's going to come to me what to write. But it was coming so fast that I couldn't type it fast enough. And pretty soon I put out everything from my heart, everything that bothered me, everything that was laying there. And each time I covered a page, I completed a page, when the page fell down on the floor, because I didn't have the thing, it felt like something fell off my shoulders, on my chest, and I was able to breathe better, and I felt better, I felt easier. And until I finished, I wrote it down. I didn't know what I'm going to do with it, but I wanted the story. I wanted the story done first. But then, when I started to write, then I kind of felt freer to talk about it, because until then, I couldn't talk about my experiences. And after I was writing the book, just after I started to write the book, I felt free. I could talk about it.
Can you wait for it to warm up? Can you hear me? No, yes. Okay, so this is the edited version that we put together, that was put together by the UC Davis. And I'd love it if I could get feedback from you as far as what your thoughts are on this. The one thing I didn't talk about was when my parents were living in Oakmont here, I came to visit them one day, and my mom, louder. Can you make it louder? Okay. Can you hear me now? Okay, so I came to visit in Oakmont, and my mom shows me this brochure she got from the Holocaust Memorial Museum, and it's got this photograph of Hungarian Jews arriving at Auschwitz, and then she points to these five figures and says, this is me and my mom and my three sisters. You know, and I'm saying, sure, okay. She goes, you don't believe me, do you? I go, well, I can't, it's hard, you don't look like this. Of course, she's in her 60s or 70s, or 80s by then. And so then she went and found the old photograph that had been sent to an uncle that lived in the U.S. that was they were able to get. And there it was. And so that was what was shown for two photographs in the in that film. So that was pretty special. And there was, you know, there's been kind of like a, it's felt like, what was the reason that the one time a Nazi photographer took photographs of a train load coming into Auschwitz, the one time that that happened, and it just so happens that one of the photos was with my mom and her family, you know, was there a reason for that? So it's been a real important piece to put into the, to get into the book and so forth. And in our book, I also addressed what it was like. Well, I was able to find photos from the Holocaust Memorial Museum that showed the commandant's photos, and it showed the Nazi officers, and they're all playing accordion, and they're singing songs, and they're lighting the candles on the Christmas tree, and they're living this, if you just look at the pictures, they look like really nice people. Yet while this is happening on the other side of the wall, they're killing 10,000 women, children, seniors a day. How can you do that? How can that happen? How can you forgive those people? And then you go to the next level, it's like, well, do you go to the town right next to them? They knew damn well what was going on. Can you forgive those people for not doing anything? And do you go, how far do you go, you know, to the bigger towns in Germany? Do you go throughout Europe? Do you go to the United States, where we refuse to let the St. Louis ship come in, and we refuse to let any immigrants come in? The memories are repeating themselves here with our country now. So I had trouble with that forgiveness part, and that was something that when I first wrote the book, my section, when I handed out the first edition to my family and my cousins, they said my mom's part was really good, but my part was really dry. So I took about 3 months to rewrite it and to get into it more and to get into what was the second generation and how do I forgive? What do I forgive? And I remember typing on the computer, I forgive G-E, it was really hard to type that out, Germans. I typed that out because I figured, well, let me go with my mom's forgiveness part because I never wanted to have anything to do with Germans prior to that. And I typed that up, and I remember going to my mom's house, and my dad had already passed away, and my mom was there, and another Jewish lady who was younger than me was there. And I was saying this, and then the lady said, how can you say you forgive the Germans after what they did? And I go, well, yeah, there was the one German that killed my grandfather, but at the same time, the capos and the people that were working in the camps were Jewish women, and they were the ones that beat the shit out of my mom and did all the bad stuff, too. So it was Jewish people that did that. And my mom, she was a wise lady. She told me, you don't have the authority to forgive all of the Germans for what they did. The only people that have the authority to forgive are the ones that the crimes were done to. So those 6 million Jews that were killed and all of the others that were in the camps that were tortured and beat up, those are the ones that can forgive the Germans that did that to them. So it came to me that, well, I can't forgive those Nazis, and I really can't forgive all of the ones that didn't, all of the people that just looked the other way and didn't do anything. But I can forgive the Germans that were born after the war, because they were innocent. They didn't do anything. And it was interesting, as we wrote that, as I wrote that up, and as I was working that part of the book out with my mom, and we were in Maui in Hawaii, working on it there, I think. And my mom fell down some stairs and injured her knee, and we had to take her to Kaiser in Maui, which is not like Kaiser in Northern California. It's a different world there. And so as we go in, she's going to get her her x-ray, and we go into the x-ray technician, and she's this blonde lady, she's probably in her 40s, and she's all bubbly and happy, and she's got all these drawings on the walls that all these kids are drawing. Oh, it was so nice to come and be here. And she was just a real happy lady, and she said, yeah, you can come back with us as we take the x-ray. So I got to go back into the room and be behind the window where the lady was. And she gets my mom on the table and comes back to take the x-ray. And I see her disposition has just changed. She's not that happy lady anymore. Something's going on. I go, something's wrong here. And she goes, takes the x-ray, walks back to my mom. And then I see her. She grabs my mom's arm and points to the tattoo. And she goes, you were in Auschwitz, weren't you? And my mom says, yes. And then the lady breaks down crying. And she starts to beg my mom for forgiveness. My mom goes, forgiveness for what? And she goes, well, one of my uncles was one of Hitler's advisors. And she goes, well, you weren't even born then. You're not responsible for having an evil or bad uncle, you know. So yeah, you're forgiven. And it was interesting. I thought that was like, it was kind of heavy duty. Why would that happen in front of me right after I'm writing all this stuff down? And then as we're flying back from Hawaii to California, we're on the plane, and there's three seats, my mom, I'm in the middle, and this young lady, probably in her 30s, is sitting next to me, and she's got a little bit of an accent. I ask her, well, where are you from? And she goes, well, I'm from Turkey. So I start talking, I go, so what about the Armenian genocide? You know, we start talking about that, and she completely jumps at me. She says, there was no Armenian genocide. The Armenians attacked us, and we just defended ourselves. And I thought, well, I can't really talk to her, but here's a situation where it seems like Germany has admitted what they did. Turkey is denying it. The people that are living in Turkey that are going by what the government is saying are just living a lie. And it was interesting because then furthermore, a couple of weeks later, I was at a retreat in San Diego, and I was telling people they want to know what you do. So I said, well, I do real estate projects and different things, and they could care less. And I said, well, we're writing this book. We just wrote this book. That got them excited, these ladies. And we were talking. I was telling them about the Holocaust. And when I got done talking to them for about a half hour, 40 minutes, I turned around, and there's this lady standing behind me. And she goes, Dennis, can we go grab a bite to eat? Can we go to the lunch together? I go, sure. She goes, did you know I was German? And I go, yeah, I could tell by your accent. And then she starts to talk to me, and she's like in her early 40s, and she starts to break down crying, and she starts to beg me as a second generation to forgive her for what happened in Germany. And it kind of hit me that there's still a lot of healing that needs to happen, and that the it's not just the second generation of the people that were the victims, but it's also the second generation and so forth of the perpetrators' kids. So it's a scarring situation on both sides. And so that was pretty heavy duty for me to realize that. It's something to think about too. So I don't know if there's any questions at all. If anybody has any questions, I'd love to ask them. Yes, Robin? She didn't explain why, but my understanding of why is, A, it dehumanizes people, and they wanted to make them look and feel more like animals. It also is a lot easier to go do all these bad things to people that don't even look like people anymore. And then they were using the hair for products that they could use, too. So it was a combination of those things. There's probably other reasons, too. Yes, any other questions? Oh, come on. It's got to be something. Yeah.
Did you ever think about subtitles? Or
Okay, that's a good idea. We can integrate that. What was said is that he thought that it might be a good idea to put subtitles on the film so that people could read what was being said also and understand it. Yeah. Yes. My mom always had a strong identity, and before she started writing the book, she was carrying a lot of anger in her, and so she wasn't always a nice person to be with at all times, and so as she wrote the book, that allowed her to let go of a lot of what was bothering her. So that was the big that's how she transcended, and how that was a big benefit. And I think that's something she's always advised to people that are going through hard times or emotional times, is to sit down and write about it, just get it out of you and get it onto the paper. And that just was a healing process for her. Yes. How did she transition from German authority to freedom? And that was as she was on that death march, which is what it was before. They started with 1,250 women, and there were 250 at the end. So over 1,000 of them died. They were shot, killed, whatever. As the Russians were coming in, as the Americans were coming in, and as the Nazis were realizing that they better get out of their uniforms and start to hide so they don't get caught. That's when they basically told her, run, because they were, after the SS guards had huddled together, they realized they better get out of their uniforms and pretend like they're citizens. So that's how that transition happened. That's when she ran and met and found the farmer. Yes?
Dennis, I'm sure there are many people in here who knew Lillian. That's
Wow.
Lillian in that film. You get her wonderful humanity and who she was as a person. And it comes through in the film, and I think it's really a wonderful film.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Anything? Yes? Thank you. Back in 1991, when my dad and mom were both alive, we flew back to Hungary and took the train over to Újhorod Ungvar, which is the town mom was in Radvanc, which is like a suburb or a small town next to it. My dad lived in the Carpathians, in Dubrovnik, which is nearby, but we had a cousin, I guess, or a cousin of a cousin that was able to take off work and drive us around. And I remember I was filming my mom as we're walking around Radvanc, and she thinks it's a street that she was born on, and we're filming. And then she walks up to this gate, which has got an awning over and all kinds of grapevines. And I'm just, okay, well, let me film. And then all of a sudden she starts speaking to some lady in Hungarian. And then the gate opens up and she walks in, and I'm just following, and it's all, I don't understand a word that's being said. The next thing I know, we're going into this house, and once we're in the house, my mom breaks down crying. She says, this was our house. And I was able to film inside the house and visit and see. It was a real small house. I mean, talking about, in this country it would be definite poverty. Over there it was luxury, or it was good living. But we were invited to come back later. This was like a third generation lady that invited us over. And we came back later that evening to visit. And the grandmother, which I believe is the lady that told my mom and my aunt, get out of here, this is our house, you don't belong here. She starts talking to my mom, and she's like saying, so you're living in the United States now, right? And she goes, yes. She goes, you know, the roof on our house is leaking, and it would be really nice if we could get some help here to fix that. And I was like, it's such a different reality from, you know, it was amazing to see that or to hear that.
What'd your mom say?
She just let it pass. There's not, what do you say to someone like that? I don't know. Yet the kids were all friendly and very nice. So it was, they were all interested in hearing about my mom and so forth. So it was interesting. Yes?
Will the video eventually be available like in the DVD format versus?
What I'm planning on doing is cleaning it up more. I think we submit through Diane through your Moodle that there's like different questions and contact information for me. So if I could get feedback from the students here or from all the people here as far as suggestions, there's a lot more that was edited out that could be put in, and I think I need to work on that. But I need help because I'm not the person that can pull this one together by myself. So if there's anybody here that has a desire or some expertise that could maybe assist me, I would love that. Yes? What? My parents were born in Czechoslovakia. My grandparents were born in Hungary. If I would have been born in the same house, I would be born in the Soviet Union. And if my son Daniel was born in the same house, he'd be Ukrainian. So it's changed four times since then. Czech, Hungarian, German. She learned Yiddish in Auschwitz. Picked up Spanish here, English here, a bit of Hebrew. Right. Anything else? Any more questions? Yes.
Just an observation. I have a good Egyptian friend, and he reminds me of some of the terrible things that the Brits did over the years, a long time ago, more than 100 years ago, so I can relate to what you've been saying about your friend. If I think back to my
right. It's hard. We need to stop genocides from happening. Yes, Tish. What? Say that again. I couldn't hear you. Say that again. Yeah. Exactly.
And that
yes. Yes.
One of the things I always found most moving was your mother's message to students in terms of how to deal with intolerance and how to deal with hatred. And I wonder if you have any words there or if there's anything in addition that might be on those hours that weren't on that isn't yet on this version.
Yeah, she
because
was.
That for me was one of the most moving and important things as we have survivors still going out in the schools. We have people like you who are descendants of the Holocaust, descendants of the Armenian Genocide. What do you want to
We had that. It was the first few words she was saying were kind of got glitched without the volume. What she was saying is to let go of your anger before it turns to hatred, and to go and talk to other people, to ask for help, to get help, to talk to people, even if it's a police officer, whoever it is, your teacher, family, whoever it is you can talk to, but to get it out of your system and to work on that. The tolerance part is almost like if you see something going on that's wrong, where somebody's getting abused or something is not, you know when there's something wrong going on, it's time for you to stand up and to say, to try to either correct it or to go get help, be it another teacher or get a police officer to come and help out the situation, but not to stand by and just look the other way. And that's real important for all of us to do. And that's been a big part of her message, and I hope that that's something that we all can step forward to do, and I think that's what we're kind of facing. We're facing that today, and it's sad because after the Holocaust, there shouldn't have been any more. And now, as you're learning in the genocide classroom, there's been several more genocides that have taken place, and there are genocides that are happening right now. And be it Syria, be it Sudan, or whatever, and however many I don't know about, it just keeps going on. And so what is the message? What is it that you guys can all do to make a difference? And I think that's a part of the question and the problem that I had was, you've got the ability, we all here have the ability to make a difference. We can go and step forward and do something to help out either Syria or Sudan or wherever and make a difference and try to get things to happen either through, there's different ways to do it. There's different groups that are trying and you can become part of it. Versus you just look the other way and don't say anything. And that was part of the forgiveness part that I had to go through. Well, can I forgive all the Germans and all the world that looked the other way while this was happening? And the same thing's happening today with Syria, with Aleppo. What are we doing? What are each of us doing to try to make a difference? Because that's really the power that we have, that we can try to make some differences happening. And there's ways to do that.
Thank you.